American graduate. So welcome to my class. I want to haha, aloha aina organizer. I, along with many people, helped to put this 100% grassroots community event, informational event, on for you tonight and for the people in the live feed. I want to tell you a little bit about what Aha Aloha Aina is, who we are, and then we will get into our program. You can open. Aha Aloha Aina is a coalition of individuals, businesses, organizations that are committed to the reaffirming our independence and the restoration of the Hawaiian Kingdom. We work collectively on a model of self-governance that is completely independent on the state of control, on the control of the state of Hawaii. We have conducted over 30 community meetings on the islands of Oahu, Maui, Hawaii Island, Lanai, Molokai, as well as in Mokumonu, in cities like Salt Lake City, San Diego, Los Angeles, Seattle, Washington, D.C., as well as New York City. Over the past year, over 3,000 people have participated in Aha Aloha Aina, in our model, our Kino model of self-governance, and reaffirming our themes. Okay. Now, we believe, both working with Kanaka and not Kanaka, we provide a true model of self-determination that is independent from the control of the settler state, while we work toward our ultimate goal of independence from the oppressor settler state. Many of us are also on the front line of social justice issues, fighting for the protection of our water, to stop the desecration of our natural resources. We fight for affordable housing for all people. We fight for universal health care, to increase our teachers' pay here in Hawaii, fighting injustices done to our houseless ohana, and many other countless fights that not only improve the quality of life for Hawaiians, but for all people of Hawaii. Those who help to organize Aha Aloha Aina are also lawyers, teachers, cultural practitioners, medical doctors, college professors, students, trade workers, bus drivers, community organizers, social workers, farmers, fishermen and women, nurses, bus drivers, musicians, kumuhula, graphic designers, hunters, engineers, journalists, poets, artists, and these are just the people that I know personally. There are many kupua in our efforts that I don't know, and I don't know what they do to support their families, but I mahalo their selfless contributions to our Aha Aloha Aina. While we work toward our ultimate aina, please go to www.ahaalohaaina.com. You can also get more information by going to our Aha Aloha Aina Facebook page or going to our Aha Aloha Aina YouTube. Mahalo. Mahalo each and every one of you, and I'm especially mahalo our enthused board here tonight. That is something that I welcome, but I welcome your criticism with civility, with aloha, and with love. Sticking to the issues and leaving the personal attacks on the side. I will let you know that we organized this to kill 3 minutes, okay? The Hawaiian Kingdom men are violent. We are far from violent abusers. We are nurturers. We are fathers. We are caretakers of our ohana, of our ahuwa'a, and of our moku. Okay. Two, we're going to kill this once and forever. That independence people are ignorant, are stupid, and uneducated. That is far from the truth. And tonight's forum, as well as our ahuwa'aina, is going to continue to prove that myth. And three, most importantly, a myth that we are going to kill once and forever, that Lahui Kanaka, or Hawaiian people, cannot gather in a room together and have differing opinions. and it be okay. I'm a mahalo. Father, can you just move me right now? And I mahalo her voice, because that is the type of voice, inclusive voice, that we encourage at the Aha Lohaina. That is the type of voice that is a true example of self-determination. I would like to thank you. So with that, I want to thank some people first that are making this possible. You see, some of our speakers are being presented with Aha. Sister T. Henderson that brought some Aha. Right? We have our Kiaki. You see them in the red shirts. Okay? You knew us earlier. They blew the poo. You identify them in the red shirts. Our Kiai or our protectors, they are those that are going to help us to hold the conduct of Aloha so that we can continue to be successful in this meeting that we want. Okay? So I'm just going to next go over a few things of how we like to hold ourselves, okay? As a community organizer, help to facilitate groups both big and small, and one of the things that we implement is called norms and agreements. These norms and agreements are very key because in each room is different dynamics. So we are going to come up with some norms and agreements, and we have some already prepared. I really just have one. But these norms and agreements is what we're going to hold ourselves and each other accountable to, so that we can have all of our speakers present and have, most importantly, an hour of community Q&A from you guys, okay? That's what we want. We want to get there, okay? So, really, we all know that one of the only norms and agreements that I have is aloha kahi ike kahi, right? Love one another. Love one another. If we love one another, besides our differences of opinion, we can move forward. Now, I'd just like to open it up to the group. What is another norms and agreement that we can all hold ourselves to? Feel free to just share popcorn style. That means you just throw it out there. You can shout it out and I'll echo it out. Is there any norms and agreements that we would like to collectively hold ourselves together to make sure that we
can be respectful?
Be respectful. Can we agree to be respectful? Last apple hand. Is there another norms and agreement we want to hold ourselves to?
Kapu aloha.
Kapu aloha. Can we hold ourselves to kapu aloha?
Sure.
Is there any norms and agreements that anybody else would like to contribute to this group before we move on? Can we please put our cell phones on vibrate or turn them off? Can we all agree to that?
Yeah.
Vibrate or turn them off? I know, so busy our life. Put it on vibrate just for us. Yes, sir.
Addressing your concern without
hateness. Exactly. And I want to mahalo. This is my father, everybody. Apulu Iwane Momo. He's not Kanaka. Samoa, we're proud. But he's here to learn about it. And so I welcome him. Thank you, Dad. You know, we're good? We're good? All right. With that said, I would like to again go over the agenda right now before I introduce the speakers, our moderator, and our facilitator, and we'll get into our program. You can know? Okay. So, each speaker is going to be given 5 minutes to present, 5 minutes to present to the general public, to our community. Okay? After the speaker's presentation, they will then immediately have one question to answer. And these questions have been prepared from our Aha Aloha Aina organizers. Because we helped to put the Hana into this meeting, there are some questions that we want to have to ask directly, okay? After that immediate question, and all the presenters have spoken and presented, and they've answered their questions, our goal is to have an hour of community Q&A, okay? You can know? Just by a round of applause, can we agree to that? Mahalo. Thank you, Noe. I mahalo you guys for being very patient with us and our organizing crew. This is the first time we've ever done something like this, where we have opened it up to speakers. We've done Ahalo'aina. Now, with that said, I would like to introduce our speakers at this time. I'm just going to introduce them down the line, from this way, from left to right, to, from my left to this right. And then I'm going to introduce our moderators, our moderator, and then our facilitator. And then the moderator will take over, and they will control, you know? So to my far left here, we have the president of the Sovereign Council of Hawaiian Homestead Association, or known as SHAW, Mrs. Robin Danner. To her right is the president of the Council of Native Hawaiian Advancement, Mrs. Michelle Kauhane. We invited former Governor John Mahe'e. He was on it, not here. and we are, we have asked, and we have been, the invitation was accepted from the Makalehua, which is a group of young Napio organizers, Davis, and a graduate from UH Richardson School of Law, Davis Price. And the invitation was offered to Board of Trustee Peter Apo, and he's not here. And instead, we also offered for invitation to Ziri Aki, who's also part of Namakalehua, and he was a chief drafter of the Naia Puni Constitution. To my immediate right here, we have. I'm sorry, the Doctor of Philosophy and Indigenous Education. Sorry, very nervous here. My hero, all these people here, right? From Dr. Pu Puhakalo. To her right, speaking on behalf of Ahalo'aina, convener, Dr. Kalama Niyumu. To Kalama's right, good friend of mine, as well as Kia'i Yosihim of Mauna Awakea, Kao Kahi Kanuma. And to our immediate right and far right, international lawyer and expert speaker at the United Nations, Mrs. Mililani Trask. A lot of honor that went into organizing such a diverse and well expert group of speakers. So I want to just mahalo all of our organizers out there that helped this. Big mahalo to you guys. Big mahalo to all the people on the forum. Now at this time, I would like to identify our facilitator. Our facilitator in Hawaiian terms is somebody that helps to massage the conversation along, somebody that is well respected within our community that we can all collectively in regards to. I'd like to introduce from Molokai, Uncle Walter Riddy. And finally, our moderator for this evening. He's also a good friend of mine, entrepreneur, longtime advocate for the independence movement. Also from right here in Kalihi, Ikaika Hussey.
Hello, so my understanding is that the organizers were intending for two speakers from each side to speak and then to flip to the other side. So Ziri Aki is not available today, but he was supposed to speak first. So Davis, why don't you take his 5 minutes as well as your 5 minutes?
Thank you. Almighty God, Lord. So, my name is Davis Price. I see a lot of familiar faces in this room. It's a last minute invitee to fill in. And I believe a capacity. A capacity as a participant. Speaking in my capacity as a participant in the Na'i'a Puni Aha earlier this year. So, little introduction. My ohana is from Kupua, Kali, by way of a country Maui, the Kekapa'i Ha'o and Pai'o Ohana. And I am a graduate, not only of the law school, but of the Hawaiian Studies Kumaku Center, Kumakukua Kalani Center for Hawaiian Studies at UH. And it is there that I kind of got my feet wet and kind of got tossed into the activism role alongside of many of the familiar faces I see in this room on numerous issues. It was also there that I recognized my pathway forward, which was to engage in policy. I was always fascinated and always a student of our kingdom history growing up, and always raised a lot of questions about how things played out in the Christian terms that took place in that very tumultuous time. So I continued those studies. And one thing that I recognized, my kuleana, was to take on that policy role that was so critical in shaping the kingdom and our history, the future going forward from there. So what I recognized was that engagement was critical because I saw what Haoles did within our kingdom. He played a very significant role in policy making that eroded the rights of the native people for a very long time. It quickly. So I said, why can't we flip that on its head and do the same thing today? And then study history more, and you see the labor movement of the
50s and 60s.
Check. Where you had another wave of movement, political engagement from the minorities, the workers, the disenfranchised, the underrepresented, exercising their voice and taking power. And I always questioned, where was Hawaiian's role in all of these things? And there was Hawaiians engaged very much so at every level of this, but for some reason, the masses didn't seem to reap all the benefits. So as a student, I studied, how can we get our people in mass to protect our land? My family was displaced. Unfortunately, a bunch of my great-great-grandfather's daughters married Haole's dad. Essentially swindled all our land from upcountry. Hence why they ended up in Kalihi. So, how do we change these things, and how do we work with the system and utilize the tools that essentially that's all it is? To me, government is a tool. Whether it be kingdom law, state law, American law, international, it's all a tool. And the thing that I try to never forget in every step of participation that I engage in is that this is about the people and the aina. For me, I gotta look past the kingdom history. It's a small window. We have 1,000 years of history prior to that, where the focus was people and aina. And that is when our people flourished. People were surviving once the Westerners came. When the focus was people and aina, they flourished. So how do we get back to that focus? How do we get that intertwined in every piece of policy that comes out of whatever government it is we all participate in? So that said, I engaged in the AHA not as a supporter of federation, not as a supporter of independence, but how do we get down to the facts? There's so many mistruths flying around in the air. How do we get down to the facts where people can stop looking at each other as enemies on opposite sides of the battlefield, but to engage with each other? Because unless we galvanize, it's not going to be an answer. It's going to be a very hard road forward. So I went in there thinking, I like to see all these different points of view and see if we can't find one common ground. My experience was, it was not the best experience, it's not the best process, by far it was broken. That's another reason why I engaged. And I respect everybody's position, you know, to not participate, to stay outside. Everybody has a rule and it should be respected. And all those rules are significant and important. For me, I went inside to try and see where everybody's perspective is coming from, and like I said, to find out if there was a common ground. Because another understanding I had was that something I learned is by schooling, the people that I spoke with, mentors, experts, was that there is no federal recognition or independence. It doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. It's two frameworks of law, self-determination, indigenous peoples, kingdom law, nationals, separate government. Doesn't have to be exclusive of each other. So why can't we move on the path together simultaneously? And what I found in there was, no one could tell me that I was wrong, that it was one or the other. And I don't have a name drop, but significant legal experts, people that are highly respected on both sides, wouldn't give me a clear cut answer. So, that said, okay. So that said, again, so to find common ground, and what I found in there was a lot of hope, and that we can have very, very emotional, differing opinions, still come to a common ground, and still respect each other's opinions. And that no matter what we choose, there is no clear-cut choice that says, I'm going to shut you out if I go this way, or I'm going to shut you out if I go this way. There is nothing like that. Like I said, government is a tool. Law is fluid, subject to political will determined by the people. As long as the people move together, can I stop them? Plain and simple. So all the bashing that goes on back and forth, all the old kingdom guys ignorant, regular guys sellouts, it's got to stop. And I'm hoping, I participated with the young people in that room to try and, I guess, set an example from our generation that's kind of tired of that rhetoric, tired of the bashing. Yeah, we want to figure out a way forward. Call us idealistic. Call us sellouts. But if you talk to us, I think you find out that that's not the case. So, sooner or later, I think this next generation is going to take the reins. And we're rock and roll, plain and simple. You know, and we're going to do it together. I stood side by side along other young people, Barakawapahi, staunch kingdom advocate. I don't oppose him. I don't think he opposes me. You know, so it's all about how we go towards the path together. And we're not trying to miseducate or diseducate. I think the independence discussions need to keep going. I think the work that's happening in the international arenas need to continue to happen. But that doesn't mean that because someone is working on a different platform or working within the framework of the state or the United States, that they oppose those guys. Or vice versa, it shouldn't be. And so I'll close with that. I think there's Q&A afterwards. It might be more helpful, but mahalo for having us, and Josh, mahalo for inviting you.
So, the question that I'd like to pose to you, David, and this actually might be a question that the three of you might be interested in responding to, is that, you know, we all woke up to a very different world yesterday.
Yeah.
And given this great new world in which we find ourselves, with the president-elect that has already said that he's going to pick, you know, an oil executive to run the Environmental Protection Agency. What are the prospects for processing such as Meli Altuni or federal recognition in general, given this incredibly rightward change in U.S. politics?
How long do we have to answer? I'll ask it too.
response. If there's ever been a time that we need to do exactly what I just said, now is the time. Simple as that. Our natural resources, very much so, are going to be under assault. Probably more so on the mainland, on the continent in here, at first. I don't know. Who knows where they like to go? But if there's ever been a time that we need to galvanize, raise our voice loud, all of us stand together, is now. Very much so. But I don't think federal recognition, to me, is putting the cart before the horse. Federal recognition is not going to solve the problem. The people are going to solve the problem.
My response to that question would be that I have confidence that we are a resilient people. We have been. This is one president. We will have another president and another president. That doesn't change what we fight for to better the conditions for ourselves. So every administration comes with pluses and minuses, as this one will, so we work harder. But I also believe that there is so much work to do here at home first. We don't need to talk about recognition without first having a government. We should focus on standing up the government that must be recognized or could be recognized someday or another. But right now, there is nothing for the federal government to recognize because we have not stood up a Native Hawaiian government.
And that's how I'm going to address you today and talk about what we believe is what we need to do as Hawaii, which is simple, Kuakalaka. Kuakalaka means to stand as a Hawaiian, to live as a Hawaiian, and to be a Hawaiian. And on a day-to-day basis, it's real simple. You know, we live the values that the Olelo Noeau tell us to live like. We practice our own traditions that we learn from our kōmo. We use Hawaiian as the preferred mode of communication if we can. If we cannot, we talk pidgin, that's all right. We perpetuate the mindset of our kupuna as a way of life. Now, what was the mindset of my kupuna, my grandpa, born and raised in Kalihi? He and his parents, they were for independence. In fact, in 1897, 90% of everybody in Hawaii was for independence. Fast forward to 2014, I went to Keaukaha, because I'm from the Big Island, 100% of the Hawaiians there were for independence. So nothing has really changed. However, when you read this palapala that they're supposed to be using to define who we are, they said, oh, there were general comments, both supporting and opposing. Full lie! 100% of the people were against it, and here we get this of supporting and opposing stuff. Moreover, this Manawa continues to be misrepresented. I got this letter from Macy, not that I'm pursuing her or anything, but I got that letter just happened yesterday from Macy, and it says the final rule follows extensive, passionate comments. The comments was, do not create a rule. That doesn't follow making what we told them to do. And so the promises are totally hewa and incorrect. They're saying that many Native Hawaiians contend that their community's opportunities to thrive would be significantly bolstered if we became an American tribe. Yeah. And they claim that these formal government-to-government relationships between the Indians and the U.S. government are enormously beneficial to Native Americans. Now let's look at the Native American reality. Poverty has prevailed on preservation. Highest poverty and unemployment rates in the nation. As far as education, which is my kind of background, disproportionately underachieving, dropout rate twice the national average. So, you know, as an educator, what are the benefits of federal recognition? Well, we have two options. First of all, neither these procedures nor NAGPRA mentions one word about education. However, the top 13 countries in the world in education all make sure that in their constitution it talks about the importance of the right of education, because that's how we establish a culture of education where education is valued. And so, right now, with federal recognition, we have two options. Everything stays the way it does, and education stays under the state. And we know that the Department of Education has failed our 70,000 KKE, and not just this generation, but the one before and the one before, miserably. The other option, would be to create new schools, like Hawaiian versions of BIA schools. And let me tell you, I'm in Indian country. You wouldn't want to attend for your kids to attend BIA schools. So, but what are the possibilities of independence? And for that now, we need to look at the United Nations Declaration of the Rights of Indigenous People, which is an important standard that was set for the treatment of indigenous people. Now, that was voted in 2007 by 144 states, but not the United States. So that means they're not in favor of this. And so, the procedures, zero reference to this most important document for indigenous people, even though it was signed into law by President Obama. Article 3, right to self-determination. Article 4, 8, right not to be forced to assimilate, which is happening right now. And then most importantly for me, right to set up and manage our own schools and education system. That can only happen under independence, not under any kind of a federal Indian kind of policy. And so we have a long history of quality education. We have the first public school system west of the Rockies, and we still believe in education. 1997, the Native Hawaiian Education Council calls for the establishment of a Hawaiian system of education. Today, we are working on a Ecoversity education with Aloha. We're moving forward, and we're excited about that movement. We're working towards decolonization. The time is now to make it go into the next step, which is to resist meaningfully and actively, to restore our practices and to go back to doing the things that will work for us. Mahalo.
So my question for Dr. Kanakala is, right now, Native Hawaiian youth, we represent, our youth represent a significant percentage of the Department of Education public schools, something like 25 or 26%, with Filipinos being another 25%. What do you think we should be doing now with our current Department of Education system as part of a transition to a solid future?
I think we've tried everything we can. Personally, I know I have. I tried to be a good POE teacher. I tried to have a school within a school. I tried to have a school outside, like a charter school. The reality is the Department of Education is mired in institutionalized racism, and for the first time, they are actually talking about it. So HSPA is talking institutionalized racism, and that needs to stop. You know, we cannot have 9% Japanese teachers and 27% Hawaiian students, but only 9% Japanese students and so little Hawaiian teachers, so that it's totally skewed. So I really think the only thing that will work is for us to create our own system. We're already working on it, and we just need everybody to be part of that. If we, 70,000 parents, stood up and said, we're not going to send our children to a school anymore that is known to be racist, then they got to do something. And they should give us the $600 million that they spend every year not educating our own children and let us educate our own children.
Just to help the rest of the speakers out, can somebody get a phone and just put your timer and put it, face it toward the speakers so that they know what the timing down is? That would be great, and that would be easy for us so that we can actually just glance over to you and know how much time we have left. So, Lahaina, I'm Dr. Kalama Okainanihio. I'm one of the people who are organizing the Lahainas throughout the island. Next slide. So I think that one of the things that really, you know, surprised a lot of people was that Trump was elected. Independence people are not surprised. A lot of them are realized that what has happened in the past is happening now. It's been happening since the beginning of America has started. They have never done justice by indigenous people, and they have never. That right now, they got this, you have a president that is the result of underestimating the American people, and then also underestimating the level of racism that's happening in the nation itself. Next slide. And I wanted to point out that part of it is because the American system is broken. And what they've done is, I'd like to do a little bit of an analogy of how they've completely been disconnected from their own people and how it's been propagated to over here. And so one of the things that they did was, in 2011, they created a commission. And then what they did was they didn't ask our community, they just assigned it to them. Because they thought they knew better. Just like, you know, the Democratic National Party thought they knew better and could put Hillary in charge. Next. So what they did is, without our consent, they kind of kept on, again, you have a WikiLeaks, you have all these things going on, where Hillary is like swindling the Democratic Convention, right? Then you have here, trying to make things fit rather than actually getting true consent from the people. They rolled over these names, tens of thousands of names from the Kanayola Vala list over into this roll. Next slide. And what they had was, in 2016, 150 unelected Na'iapuni participants created a constitution without really going out into the community. Next. And one of their first acts, for the interest of expediency, to get this constitution written within 10 days, was decided to not allow the community to present concerns. And as a result, 8 Kanaka were arrested at the gates of this private country club simply for wanting to bring our concerns to the table. And the question is that a nation for our people? And right now, what we're looking at is a major land grab. Our analysis is, and we don't all agree with this, but what's the main reason why they want to do this? Why are they pushing it through? If you look at, you study First Nations and how they have to spend all this time to get recognized with DOI, they want to quiet the title. They want to quiet the land title, 1.8 million acres of seized land. And the only land that we have guaranteed right is Kohololawe. Are we going to live there? Can we live there as a people? Next. And the roles are, this is not anything new. Back a couple of years ago, 2014, OHA itself put out this informational poster that said, if you do not sign up for this role, you threaten the rights of you, yourself, and all your descendants forevermore to be considered a Native Hawaiian. Okay? That's some really intense stuff. We're talking about 80% of our people not on this list. Next slide. So the question then becomes, step back a minute, is federal recognition a healthy form of government? That a doctor I can go for miles about all of the different statistics that show that it has really failed the Native American people. Next slide. But really, for those of you who have been following, paying attention, during an administration that's supposedly friendly to Native Americans compared to what Trump is supposed to be. Here we have Standing Rock Sioux standing up for clean drinking water for 12 million people. And this is the response, a militarized response, where they attack unarmed Standing Rock Sioux with over-enthusiastic, like violent, militarized concussion grenades, mace, attack dogs, next slide. And we're also looking at a president right now who completely denies that climate change is occurring. And we're, so this is not just one person, this is a representation of American policy. While this was happening against somebody that's supposed to be one of the guys that is pushing for climate change preparation, actually signed three pipelines through to allow this crude oil to go through the United States. He's not stopping it, he's continuing fossil fuels. Next slide. And the thing is right now, as people don't always really consider this an option. But this is something to think about. And it's not just for us. I show here Tokelau. They're right now, their islands are going underwater. And they're saying, we are not drowning, we are fighting. And our islands soon may rise, and we need to realize that there is a choice coming right now. And for those of you at the school, this is a position, I'm telling you that our people have sustainable resources, sustainable systems in place. Next slide. And what we need to do is Aloha Aina, next couple slides over, next slide. This, look at all of our different sciences, and one of them is healthy systems and governance. And right now what we have over here, this is a Kalaimoku, our traditional form. This is what we should be basing on. This is our structure on Ahaloha Aina, and where everybody has a place. And that's what any pathway for. There's one thing I agree with. There's a lot of things to disagree, but it's one thing that we definitely all agree with is that we need to come together, we need to unite. This is a very scary time for a lot of people, and we need to do it in a very powerful way, in a real way, in a way that's not false and manufactured, in a way that honors the work of every single person here. Mahalo.
I'm going to ask a hard question to you, which is, the federal recognition process is more or less well understood. What is the complementary process for independence?
Well, I think that there's I wish I had known I had that question. I have a really great infographic flowchart of independence that it's relatively complicated, but everybody sees it as like, oh. It's like everyone's like, what's your plan? I was like, we got a plan. And part of that plan, though, fundamentally, if you look at the United Nations, we definitely consult them about this process, and they said any government at its fundamental basis needs to start with building unity and education within the community. And that is what we're doing right now. Aloha Aina is going out without any state and federal monies. We are going out to the community and actually listening to them. You know, we don't always agree with some of the things that they're asking for. We're having a challenging time, okay? What happened when we had the Halabais out there to educate people about what was happening with Latino community? Because they weren't doing it. With all their millions of dollars, they didn't go out to our communities. So us, with zero budget, with only the aloha of our community, went out and we listened to the people. And they said, we need an aloha for our people. We're like, gosh, we're broke. All of us up here are broke. What are we going to do? We can't afford to have 2 weeks and even a month where we get together. So you know, we went to every community, any community out there that wants to be a part of this aloha, organizing your community, we will go to you and we will come with you and we will listen to you. And out of that came this. Not everybody in Aloha Aina is very excited about including everybody's voices here. But we are here because we need to start talking. There's one thing that we need to do is we need to start talking to each other. And there's a lot of guns standing back and forth. I feel like it's North Dakota again. I just came back from North Dakota. I was like, oh my God, it's like, you know. But That's the first thing that has to happen. The next thing as we're moving along is that we need to build international alliances. We need to go and we have to recognize first that we are an independent country and that we have leveraging that we can utilize throughout the world. That there are a lot of people throughout the world that really want to have a neutral country here rather than a military giant. And the other thing that I didn't really point out before, I've never really answered this question directly, but Rome fell from within. Empires rise and fall. Part of the plan is understanding that the United States has proven and they're showing that they are unable to care for even their own population. So it's time for the peoples throughout the world to unite and care for the people where they are and to move away from this global domination that has been happening and has dominated and destroyed the planet. We need to move forward to a new future.
I'm going to tell Donald Trump that stuff about Rome. He's not going to like it very much. Yeah. So for our next speaker, I just wanted to give some respect to Robin Danner, because we haven't always agreed, and I think there's a lot of folks on both sides of this tables that have not agreed for many years. And it takes a lot of courage and aloha for your people to come to this kind of event. I want to say thank you personally for Robin.
Fishing, and then my parents were teachers, and I spent a lot of time on the Indian reservations of the Navajo, the Hopi, the Apache, in their educational systems, and my parents were then part of the self-determination movement of the indigenous people of Alaska to free themselves from the Bureau of Indian Affairs educational system. So Ku, you might be speaking of it, but I actually witnessed the breaking down of a BIA school and the self-determination of a Native people. And my mother, as a Native Hawaiian, wanted to be a part of that. And they opened the first non-BIA high school and elementary school in rural Alaska to break the bonds of wardship and for the last 40 years have operated their own education. So I don't think that our situation is different. I think we all have different experiences. I'm a banker by training. I want to congratulate the organizers, especially Haleni and Shane and others for this gathering. I mean, when I saw the materials presented, and just the logistics of everything, I want to congratulate you on a job well done for tonight. It actually reminded me of about 20 years ago when we were all part of, and still part of, Kalahui. And when Kalahui raised money from the federal government through the ANA program and funded hundreds of workshops under the leadership of Millie Lunny, when we worked together, and then when I met Haleni and Shane was about almost 20 years ago. They came on board with Kalahui, and we worked on Project Hawaiian Justice, which was a Kalahui initiative to understand and put forward one of the three rings of sovereignty that we learned so well through the Kalahui work from the 1980s. I didn't get started until 1993, which was about federal acknowledgement. Federal recognition. What I want to respond to is that we have got to stop mischaracterizations. We need to be in control of our own education. We need to be in control of our own businesses. We need to grow Native-controlled businesses, our educational schools. The charter school movement and the indigenous education has been wildly successful. But the Native Hawaiian Education Council, for example, that Crew spoke about, was not formed by the Kingdom of Hawaii. was not formed by the state of Hawaii. It was legislated by the federal government, the Native Hawaiian Education Act. So my message with that is that we cannot be all for and all against. We as Hawaiians, given our history, given where our children are, given where our spouses are, given where incarceration is, we must take every tool. We must not deny ourselves, our elders, or the next generation of millennials any tool, whether that is a state tool, a federal tool, or an international tool. That is the reality. And what I have come here to tell you is that very strongly, one of the mistakes we are making because it's sexy, because it's easier, is that we think it's independence or a native government-to-government relationship with the United States. And we have got to stop selling that snake oil. It is not one or the other. It is both. No Hawaiian should be opposed to independence. It's in our DNA. And that is a pathway that must be traveled, traversed consistently. And it will take many generations. Because until the global power changes and the United States is no longer in charge of the UN, you can worship the UN. But that is the United States today. They are on the Security Council. They have veto power. That is the reality we live in today. So we keep the fire burning and the work that is being done on the international level, just as Indian people are doing. And we must grab hold of every tool. And federal recognition, again, is not a healthy government, young lady. Federal recognition is not a government. It is not a form of government. It is a relationship. The government is what we may choose. And so my message to our people is stop the mischaracterizations just because it's fun and it's sexy and it's cool to be Malcolm X for 5 minutes. We got to do the hard work of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Both of them, our unborn, deserve our best minds, our best debates. And I tell you, coming from someone who has been demonized in front of my grandchildren, who has been demonized when I have Kanaka boys, we have got to stop it. So I am here to say, I love my people. I am Kanaka. And I will never disrespect another Kanaka that has a better idea or even a worse idea. I celebrate all of us. And I call on my brothers and sisters that are working hard at the front lines of independence. Ayo, you must do that. And I celebrate those that must work who brought the Native Hawaiian Education Act, who brought the Native Hawaiian Housing Block Grant through the federal system. Do not deny my children or my kupuna or my neighbors from affordable housing because we have a bone to pick about the global reality of the United States. It is neither evil nor a saint. You know this. And the final thing I have to say, on behalf of my family, on behalf of my nieces and nephews, and my kupuna that are not only Native Hawaiian, but that are Native American, I am tired of the mischaracterization of people discussing Indian issues of which you know nothing about. Federal recognition is not the cause of the terrible poverty, the alcoholism that plagues Indian country. It is no more the cause of that than it is the cause of our own abuse of alcohol and drugs. We don't even have federal recognition. So we can't blame federal recognition. In fact, if you know your history, and I'm sorry, when you know your history, American Indians suffered over 500 years of forced assimilation, of brutal murder, not even comparable to our own experience. So have a little respect. When I hear people say, I'm not an Indian, that tells me I'm speaking to someone that doesn't know that there are no Indians, does not know that the Navajo are not Indian. They are Navajo. The Comanche are not Indian. They are Comanche. Kanaka are Kanaka. Indian is a term of art, and to flip that word around as if it's offensive is offensive to me. And I think we as Kanaka need to go back to our people, go back to the ways of our kupuna, that we do not disrespect another just because it makes us feel better or bigger. So I want to, on behalf of my nieces and nephews, some of which who have left their own Aina because of some of you, 20-year-old, 18-year-old, that is not the people of my mother. And I think that I call on the kingdom, I call on the royal order here and now to implement what our elite created you for, protocol, proper behavior. I want our people on both sides to align with protocol. And my last closing is to make sure it's very clear. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the state of Hawaii, the county of Kauai, the county of Maui, that is recognized by the United States of America, that is recognized by New Zealand, by the European Union, and so on. I am for a Native-only government that is recognized by the United States. Okay? As a Native-only government, I am for the governance my people had before the short-lived term of the kingdom. We had 2,000 years of Native-only sovereignty and governance. Number two, I am for independence of Hawaiian nationals, Native and non-Native. Those are two things. So I am for Native governance and I am for independence. Okay, thank you. So, mahalo nui, I am for, I am not against. I am pro federal recognition and I am pro Hawaiian independence. Mahalo.
So, Michelle Colony with the Council for Native Hawaiian Advancement, and first and foremost, I just want to share about what CNHJ is. Because I see lots of things about what we are and what we're not. And so we are a Native Hawaiian nonprofit of over 150 members locally here in the state and nationally. I see the time. CNHA is 15 years old. We've been gathering. I've heard Aha Aloha Aina talk about 30 gatherings. We have been gathering in our community for 15 years. We have been holding forums, educational symposiums, summits, and hold an annual Native Hawaiian convention and have done so since our inception. We just celebrated last month our 15th annual Native Hawaiian convention. So when I hear people say, you don't speak for me, I don't. I don't speak for you. But I have a membership that I'm accountable for. You don't speak for me, and I don't speak for you. But we definitely convene our community, we speak to our members. Do all of our members support federal recognition? No. Skippy Iwani sits on my board. We have great debates, but he continues to come to my board. We work on housing, we work on Native Hawaiian education. We work on things that we can agree on. He does not agree with federal recognition, but he has not yet quit the board. He just re-upped for another term. But we are unembarrassed, we are unapologetic for being supporters of federal recognition. That did your DOI hearings have a lot of opposition? Absolutely. Because we stayed home. We stayed out of that chaos where when we stood up, we got booed. Where my husband stood outside the cafeteria at Makakilo because he was watching on television and knew I was coming up and said, holy crap, I let her go there by herself. So we submitted 5,124 comments, actually answering the questions that the DOI was asking And so when you get frustrated about whether they heard your voice or not, you have to answer the question being posed. The question was not whether or not you supported federal recognition. The question was, if you organize yourselves as a government, Hawaiians, how shall we, the federal government, know that it is you, the government that we should be recognizing? And we didn't really answer that question verbally. We said, go home, get out of here, a'ole, DOI. We didn't answer the question. And so, yes, we have supported federal recognition. We will continue to support federal recognition. Some people agree with Kana'i Olumalu, some people don't. Some people have a bad taste in their mouth that the names got transferred. It's like any other vote. If you don't want to show up and cast your vote to ratify that constitution, you don't need to. But some of us want federal recognition. Not recognition that says, I am Hawaiian. Recognition that the government says, we recognize you as a government. There are lots of things that we want that are the same. But right now, the work that CNHA is focused on is really about ratification of the document. If you don't like the draft constitution, vote it down. The constitution doesn't guarantee federal recognition. The constitution lays forward before you to decide on a unicameral democracy. That is the form of government. The Constitution does not say federal recognition. That is a relationship, as Robin explained. The draft Constitution that will come before our people really asks you, do you support the unicameral democracy that is laid out in that document? It doesn't ask you federal recognition or independence. That is a relationship that your government may choose to have, but first we have to stand up that government. And so CNHA right now will continue to focus on education so that we, in hopes of getting to some kind of understanding, will our people vote that up or down? And if we vote it down, then we start again. But that is where we're at. I want to be clear about CNHA's position. I have 4 seconds, so I'm going to end there and take your question.
My question is for the individuals who have decided not to participate thus far in this process. If you were to project 20 or 30 years down the line, what do you think happens to them and to their faith?
That's not up to me. That would be up to the government once we stand that up. That is not that's not my answer to give to you. But right now, participation is up to the individual. We chose to participate in the process. We wanted to participate. Those that didn't want to, a'ole pilikia. I support federal recognition, and I have not opposed, as Robin shared, supporters of federal recognition have been villainized as traitors, as corporate whores. But you cross the line when you included my child. That is off limits, right? So it's
Well, the question though was, if people, if there are Hawaiians that don't want to participate in the Na'i'aupuni, in the Constitution, in the ratification, is that your question? And what about those that don't?
But let's get back to your answer after. So I have two more presentations. Mahalo'akahi, and Lilu Lani.
Kiki vau i aho aho ia i kula ia mako lalo vai. All right. say, while God be in ignorance.
I love Manava. And I love that idea of a hot gun. I'm not doing this to be disrespectful. Okay, in a Indian couple we care.
What the hell you say?
Oye, what you care? Oye, can you learn a couple? Conway, what a couple of coffee here, Kela. Conway, what a couple of coffee here, Kela.
What the hell are you talking about?
Ah, Lalila. Ime ana pa koi ke ya he ha avina ke ya he ha avina ke ya ku e ana ke kai ko ola ma hobai ya na ma hobai ke ime ana pa koi ke ya no hobai e pini ke ya ke ba a o ke kula no pa ko ko e ale no pa ko ko ha ba a ka pon e ko ona o wa ya pa ko a pa ko o ba i ya wa no ke la me ke ko e ola no hobai ka ko me a o ka ole ro ke ka a o ho ri o ye ko me ho pa ane ya pa ko a Eli me pa'u, wa'ere wa maru wa pa'a, he mini keia, a ka, o ko upono keia, o ko kapou pono keia, a ale I pa'u.
Heka Ahimu. The synopsis of what was said was that Kahoʻokahi and many others whom were schooled in our schools that were based in our language and our culture. This is a demonstration of the great divide that could potentially continue to be that divide or to turn around and be that which unites us. And so the crux of what was said is that we have a new and younger generation that has been armed and prepared with all the very basic fundamentals, the rudimentary understandings of what it means to be Kanaka from our own language perspective, and therefore, with no disrespect to any of our people who are not fluent in our mother tongue, but merely serving as an example, it is from this foundation, and it is from this, not only a place of a mind, but a heart, and spirit that our next generations base not only the understandings but the arguments and that which our young generation will advocate for. And that is as short and sweet as I can keep it. He has said that our young people are now, we have done this. Those of us, all of us in this room who have supported Hawaiian education, we have all supported our next generation to be very, very different from that which our Hawaiians who have become very, very comfortable and very assimilated within to the American way of life through no fault of our own. This is what we are now faced with. This is actually our greatest resource, and that is our future generation.
Trump the DUI rule, and no eggs. The baby can go through 172 pages in 5 minutes. What I wanted to say was just a few points, 4 points. Number one, why are we talking about a federal rule for federal recognition? What is the purpose of this thing? It didn't come from Hawaii, it came down a few years ago. Well, if you didn't read the 172 pages, you might miss what's on page 59,114. If you read page 59,114, it tells you why we're doing this. We're doing this because some Hawaiians want to exercise inherent sovereign powers so that they can, quote, facilitate the implementation of programs and services that Congress creates specifically to benefit Native Hawaiians. The purpose of the rule is not to give to our people self-determination, but to facilitate the ability of a few to gain sole control of the congressional funding programs. Read what is in the paper, because what you're being told is not the truth. Point number two, this process, does not give our people the right of self-determination under international law. The right of self-determination is the right of all peoples, with an S. It's a collective right of Hawaiians to determine our political status. What shall be the nation that we shall create, that we shall be citizens of? And by virtue of that right to freely pursue our cultural, economic, and social development, our ability to develop our own economic system, to lay taxes, to raise revenues, to tax others who work on our land, to build housing, to build clinics, to put up schools. This is the definition of social development. What is the purpose of this? The purpose is to facilitate receiving government programs from Congress, not to allow us to form a nation. Point number three, this is not federal recognition under the current federal policy. If you go back and look up President Ronald Reagan, federal recognition of self-determination, you'll find a statement that President Reagan, a Republican, put on the record. Reagan came out and said it's time for America to stop treating Indians like wards. It's time to give them their trust lands and empower them so that they can manage their own affairs. Return to them their lands, territories, and resources. This is an excuse being called federal recognition, but if you read the 172 pages, you'll see that it says that the Hawaiian nation will never have any trust lands. All trust lands held by the state remain with the state. All those held by the federal government remain with the federal government. The only exception for the Hawaiian nation is Koho'olawe, the bombing target, littered with live bombs, no homes, no clinics, no schools for our children. That is what it says. But you didn't have the chance to read it, and no one pushing it is going to explain it to you. The Indian nations have powers the Hawaiian nations will never have. If you read the jurisdictional statutes of the United States, it says that when American Indians and their governments wish to challenge the United States, they go to the federal district court, and the United States must respond. Well, if you read what they're saying for our nation, you can try to sue the federal government, but the federal government has sovereign immunity, so they don't have to answer. That is not federal recognition that the American Indians have, not that we are Indians. One of the things that greatly concerns me is that this process requires that we relinquish our claims from the overthrow of our independent kingdom, that we relinquish it. We will never be able to retain that what was taken. And I'm very concerned with the deliberate program of misinformation coming from people like Zuriaki saying that there is no human right to restitution. This is a lie. A lie.
Those rules were adopted. So,
Kaika, that's right. Kaika, the Trump, the election of the president has no impact, no bearing on the DOI process. It's POW. In other words, what's there is a federal regulation that is written in Part 50, CFR, Code of Federal Regulations 43. There is nothing for President Obama, and there is nothing for President-elect Trump to do. It's done. It was a three-year process. It exists. It sits there in the CFR and does not have to be accessed until Native Hawaiians, until our people want to establish a Native government, operate as a government, never even use the process. So I think there's some misnomer that federal recognition, the federal rules under the Department of Interior are not a land claims settlement. There better not be any mention of land or deciding what lands will be there. The federal process was merely a process for the federal government itself to have regulations that it follows, not that we follow, but that it follows in order to extend acknowledgement to a Native Hawaiian-only government. And so that process, Ikaika, was approved. The final regulation is in place. It will now sit there. It is not waiting for any federal action. It is not waiting for President Trump to do anything or for President Obama to do anything.
Hello? Hello, Akako. I am Kumo Ali Moi Nui Kamehameha. My English name is Lansla Ha'ili Linki. I descend from Lone Kamakahiki, Eliiki, Kiawe, Kalaniopu, Ke Kuhaupio. This is why I take this title of Kamehameha. Nana, no disrespect to you, but you should stick to banking. You sound like an attorney over there. How many attorneys we have in this house, Hawaiian attorneys?
How many? I need to pause. We said earlier that part of our rules of engagement for tonight is that we would be respectful to each other. So ad hominem attacks are not allowed. Please continue.
I've been respectful. How many attorneys? Can you please do me a favor if you're an attorney? Can you please write a letter to Mr. Trump and ask him for redress? For my kingdom and our people. Red dress, very important word, very, very strong word that covers it all. Money, land, everything, the kingdom come back to us. That's all you need to do. Simple mathematics. Thank you very much. Have a nice evening.
Aloha. This is for the federal recognition panel. In the federal recognition, if it passes, does the people of Hawaii acquiesce all of their sovereign rights to the U.S. in silent agreement? And what would that hold to our people if it happens to be acquiesced to the U.S.?
The question has never been posed before court. My interpretation is no. And here's why. You have 125 approximately acts of Congress that have benefited Native Hawaiians. Benefited, or however you want to characterize it, served Native Hawaiians. You have homesteaders, you have 20,000 people on a homestead waitlist. Act of Congress. Let's not get into driver's license, paying taxes, and all those things. But just that alone, just Hawaiian programs that Hawaiians participated in. If we were ever to admit or say that that is acquiescence, the majority of our people have acquiesced. So, in my perception, no, it's all been under duress. And I think we have, if there's ever a court that's going to take that question, I think we have a solid argument. And no one's ever told me no. Professor Williamson Chang, international law expert, I posed that same exact question for him at the AHA multiple times. He told me,
He never gave me a clear answer. Publicly. So privately, he told me no.
It's a gray area.
He told me no. Legal experts have told me no.
So one of the clarifying things, I think it's a great question, but one of the clarifying points, once again, that we have to frame is that there are two processes. So when you say acquiesce, the question really is, I'm a homesteader, as Davis said, any scholarships that were taken under the Native Hawaiian Education Act, is that acquiescence? No. And then we have to remember the two. So the question you're asking really comes down to this. If you, does the federal recognition a nation-to-nation relationship domestically, not internationally, impact any opportunities we have on the international arena, which is a very separate path, and which is why I can say to you, I support both. I don't need to oppose one to do the other. So to answer your question, the answer is no.
I'd like the response, please, from your side.
We had many special responses over there, and we'll have two responses here. So I'll just start off with one, and that is that when we're talking about acquiescing, we have never, through plebiscite or referendum, this is recognized, ever said that we will go under the plenary power of the United States. Plenary is absolute. Absolute, by participating in this process, and by saying that we're going to be part of this process, we're agreeing to go under the United States. We never, our proponent never, ever agreed to this. We have never as a people ever done that. And internationally, and also morally, ethically, we stand behind the fact that our people have never acquiesced. We have never given up. We have never yielded our lands. We have never yielded our lands. And when you take a look at we have consulted the United Nations, and you look at the process, a couple things happen. When you look at a nation, really truly international recognition, you can't have just one race. That's a violation of the human race. There have been countries that have tried to do this before, and they're not allowed for very good reason. But you can go to look at the wrong party, and the wrong party are the people who were affected by the overthrow. And those are descendants of the kingdom of Hawaii. And those are all the Kanaka, but they're also non-Kanaka as well. So that qualifies. That qualifies. So there is, we might disagree on the analysis of this, but
speakers get too
we do know Native Americans. We're not the only people. That I won't pretend I'm the only person that knows and has extensive experience in American culture. Because we have learned and walked together side by side each other's struggles, prejudice, and we've on here can share thousands of stories as well. I can read internationally supporting and fighting for others, then side by side can be. So yes, we do understand this. Mahalo.
I think one thing to point out, America will proceed with you or without you. This is something that was fashioned by a few in Washington and imposed here with public hearings. Even the state legislature law said register 200,000. They spent $7 million in Omaha to register less than 20,000. And Mr. Price is saying he doesn't know any court that said that. But when the judicial watch took them to the district court in Honolulu, the Na'iapuni disincorporated themselves. Then they went ahead, threw out the goal of 20,000. They never registered the 200,000. They threw out the role of the people and said that they're going to write their own constitution without being elected by the people. What the rule says is that America is going to recognize only one nation under their rule. This is the rule. And once that nation gets recognized, they get all the kala from Congress. Congress will never recognize again another Hawaiian nation. The to abide the rules. So acquiesce.
Do you have to sign up on any other various road commissions like Kanaiolu or to vote no against the Naiyapuni constitution? Do you have to sign up for any other roads to vote no against the Naiyapuni constitution?
There was a, actually the constitution that was crafted left it open to be determined. I don't have a language in front of me. I thought she was going to be here. It was left very broad, the language, as far as how the registration would take place. But it was very clear that all Hawaiians would be eligible to vote. It didn't specify any specific registration process, and that was something that many of us went in there to fight for, so that we could make it broader than the previous Kanaka Lohala Road, because we understood that that was limited. And we heard many people say why that was problematic. So we wanted to open up other options for people to register. For example, one idea that came up, and nothing's been decided yet, was if you've ever registered for any Hawaiian scholarship from MS schools, my homeland, Poha, Aulike, whatever, you have to prove Hawaiian ancestry, you can bring your documentation and go vote at a polling place. That was something that was being advocated for. Again, not decided. But that's the type of voices that was in that room. No, it's not, it's undecided.
So it's undecided.
It's open. You may not have to, hopefully not, in my opinion.
So you guys don't know yet? You guys don't come to that conclusion, or is it just, we don't know?
It's going to, it'll hopefully be decided soon. You know, I will have to agree with Dr. Trask, because I feel like the federal recognition process and this nation building process that's been established is stalled. Yeah, but it's separate from the nation building process of just our people coming together and discussing like this how we're going to move forward and how we can build on that constitution, or in my opinion, even the Kalahui constitution, which was incorporated.
Wait, Rob, wait.
I'll give you a chance to respond. Okay, so I'll look at that.
Written by elected representatives of Hawaiian peoples. It was copyrighted, as you well know, because Dr. Kupuna advised us, the one that's right here, Lani Ho'ohuli, that the time would come when there would be pro-federal Hawaiians who would try to take the Constitution and manipulate it into something else. It will never help the Kalahui Constitution. If you do an educational process and bring designated representatives from the community, you will have a good constitution that will have many things that Kalahui has in it. But you cannot designate those from Oha, Naiyapuni, Nashai, CNHA, to lock themselves in a room and come out with a decent constitution. That's as Kalahui has pointed out. You guys wrote the Constitution and forgot about educating the children. You never think about that, yeah?
Another thing that I want you to understand is the blessing of knowing who you are. And it's not to be having to design this BS. Plain and simply, we're a Pono people. I mean, Pilipo, Susa, I love you.
until we call that name, the people Sousa, it's a Portuguese settlers, held in there. All his 80 years here in Hawaii, for our people, for his wife, for his children. I love the people. He's a perfect example of what will be new Hawaii. Beyond the Pope, but also inclusive of those that are hanging you there. Where I'm getting confused is, he not Kanaka? He is Kanaka alone. So I have resorted to knowing that Pipo is a person that I look up to. As much as he says, why are you that one person that supports me? What about the rest of them? I'm that important person. That's the difference. I am one. And I now know that Pipo is Pili Pono. And that's what we need to be said. And those of you that are suffering with the different cancers that the United States has bestowed on our people, we need to enlarge Queens Hospital to accommodate all of you. That's the problem. We need to be a homogenous society. Once again, nothing's wrong with being homogenous, especially when we are born direct from God. Simple. No questions, no more discussions. Ah, Pao, Amen. And Filippo, I honor you.
Hello, my name is Tani. I like to pull some things into perspective. And one of the biggest problems I think we have that sends a lot of confusion is the terminologies, the definitions that the U.S. uses that we subscribe to, which we should. Number one is we made our self-determination while we were a kingdom, and it was reaffirmed at the Kui petition. So that which they are asking is for domestic or internal self-recognition. So it's a different thing altogether. The same goes with indigenous. We are not indigenous. Kalikioli established us as aboriginal, which is Kanaka Maoli. And we were recognized as an international country, independent and sovereign. So you cannot use their words because they forget to tell you what they're asking for. They're asking for domestic recognition. People use the words colonization. We are not colonized. We cannot be because we were recognized as an independent nation among the European nations. So we cannot reach that word. There are many words that they throw out. You have to step out of that U.S. box and speak up as a Hawaiian Kingdom subject, which I knew as a child when I was cognizant about things going on from age 8. That's been over, what, 60 years, 70? Who knows? I'm not counting anymore. But the thing to remember is that you have to know who you are. You have to speak as an equal to the United States, not follow their manifest destiny doctrines, which they are imposing upon us. And so, there's nothing wrong with those who want to be foreign Americans. But when you go into the federal recognition program, which we all know from the APAPA bill, you cannot negotiate anything from the Hawaiian Kingdom.
So you being Hawaiian Kingdom subjects, you must first renounce your citizenship to the Hawaiian Kingdom and formally naturalize to the United States to join that little tribe. And I think it should be mandated.
Here's a question that came in from our hashtag AAA Forum 2016. In the wake of white America's apparent repudiation of ethnic, religious, sexual, and cultural tolerance in this country, do you feel comfortable committing our a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States. This is for Rotterdam.
You cut in and out a lot, so I'm going to try to paraphrase what I thought I heard.
I can repeat it. In the wake of white America's apparent repudiation of ethnic, religious, and sexual and cultural tolerance in this election, do you feel comfortable committing our Lahui to a continued, dependent, and acquiescent relationship with the United States?
Well, first of all, no one is committing our Lahui to anything. There are many initiatives, there are many different kingdom organizations that are, you know, we were part of the Lahui, there were many ahas. So that's first and foremost. But I think the heart of it, the person's question is, with the recent election, my question back to you would be, with the recent election and the description and the adjectives of what that election means to some folks in terms of being racist, etc., it was a tough election. But my question would be back to you, what does that mean? Acquiesce? Does that mean I should pull my youngest son out of school? Do I turn in my driver's license? Do I, these kinds of things. That's the kind of question that is. And if we live in the real world, tomorrow, many of us are going to go to work. We're going to get in the car and drive there. We're going to take our kids to school, et cetera. So the recent election doesn't cause us to do anything different. That is to be of a mind frame that someone else decides what we're going to do. So the Trump-Clinton election doesn't freak me out. It's not going to change where my son's going to go to school, where my grandson's going to go to school. It doesn't change how I get there. So I'm not acquiescing to anything because of that election or any other election. There have been 45 presidents in the United States, and it hasn't caused any of us, certainly not our Lahui, to acquiesce to anything.
Can we have any other comments from the other side? Any comments on that question? With Akua and with the Aina,
which is not their way of life. We know that. We know that destruction of the environment that is not in the past, but is happening right now and will continue to happen because they don't have no consciousness when it comes to either. And so to me, I'm not going to act against nothing. I'm Hawaiian and I will be Hawaiian until the day I die. And that's all I want to do. I don't want to be nothing else.
Right now, things are being held from the park all over the place.
have that 20% Wonder Ola. We have never, ever yielded that. And that is something that is hotly contested, and that's the reason why this got fast track. It was federal recognition takes so long. 2014 to 2016. You ask any Native American who is currently going through the process, it has never happened so fast. And why is that? You need to ask so why. And Standing Rock is a great example. Do they care about our indigenous people? And we know that they don't. So why would they do that for Hawaii? Because they love us so much? Because they've taken care of us so well? They want them for a reason. And you can disagree with my analysis, but you have to ask questions.
Just for the nature of the question, I like this one. He asked a question that hits home deeply. In Hawaiian men, Hawaiian women, you're gonna tell me that if I support one track, I'm not as Hawaiian as you. That's the nature of, that's the root of that question. But how we're asking about it. And then the basis of his question, the fact of his question is, how does federal recognition impact independence? It does not. You can do both, brother. Okay? So, and when you talk about fast tracking, no disrespect to Dr. Trask, Mr. Ohana, this is a published article of 1999 by Dr. Hamani Kichas, co-founder of Alahui. The title of the article is Native Social Capital, the Case of Hawaiian Sovereignty in Alahui. The whole article discusses federal recognition and why Hawaiians should have federal recognition as a native tribe. Yeah, I know circumstances have changed.
This is not federal recognition.
I understand circumstances have changed, but the point
don't
is...
Don't try to misinterpret my sister's publication,
okay. Mr.
Price.
The point is, this is not fast track.
You're lying, Mr. Price.
You're lying.
The process has started
in the 80s.
I'm not talking about your definition of federal recognition.
I understand that. So but the process for federal recognition...
Call you on.
The process for federal recognition was not more necessary.
This is not federal recognition, Mr. Price, what you're pushing.
I'm not pushing anything. I'm talking about let's get to the facts and let's stop the mischaracterization so that people, our people, don't have to feel like they're less Hawaiian when they don't understand what's going on. Okay, that's what I'm talking about. Let's get to the facts. That's why mischaracterization is so petty. It's petty to our people. Okay? You cannot mischaracterize a political entity for the livelihood of our people. I wasn't going to misquote, I was going to read a quote.
I know that there's some folks in the line who actually have, they're actually not interested in talking about federal recognition, they actually want to learn more about independence. Can we ask some of those folks to please move forward? We'd like to indicate some of those questions.
Let's just go.
I'm sorry. Let's just go to the next person. Thank you.
Yes.
I grew up Mauka of this building, and I have the facts. And the reason I have the facts is because I've been a plaintiff and civil rights attorney for 30 years. During several of those years, I was a judge. As such, when we read a document, which I have read, we look for two things. What is in the document and what is not in the document. Now, and so I'm one of those people that read the tens and tens of pages of the proposed rules as well as the established rules. What is not, well, this is an aside. We're having this forum and I'm participating in this forum, but we are leaving aside the fundamental threshold question. Why does a nation, America, have the right to dictate to another nation, Hawaii, the way in which we are to form in order for the nation, United States, to recognize the nation of Hawaii? In order to participate in this forum, we have to leave aside that threshold question. But I am not aware of anywhere factually in the history of the world or any nation has been able to dictate to another nation how that nation should be formed In order for the nation to my question is no. Ms. Stanley, you took more than your time. You did not respect the fundamental rules that we all agreed to. So let me finish my question that is meant to be directed to both panels. What is not in the DOI rules? The DOI rules do not speak about nation building. They do not use the word nation anywhere. Why is that significant? They only speak about government to government. What they do say is that if we form a Hawaiian government, if any other entity does not follow, well, first of all, you have to follow the DOI rules in order to be recognized as the Hawaiian government. And if there any government comes after that, it will not be recognized. So my question to both panels is this. We speak a lot about how independence and these rules establishing a Hawaiian government can coexist. I would like to know from both panels, how is that possible? How are we, if we do agree to support the Naʻiapuni Constitution, which is then going to formulate a Hawaiian government that can speak to the United States government, and then we build a nation, how is the independence of the nation supposed to be reconciled with this Hawaiian government? I have a question for this side and for that side.
Because there's many kingdom experts, advocates, whatever you want to call it, have stated. The kingdom was an internationally recognized government of multinational citizens. Multi-ethnic citizens. Was, is.
Stay within.
So, again, I'm telling you, this is, I'm saying.
We're discussing right the DOI rules.
You just asked how to coexist.
No, we're discussing, you are here advocating the Department of the Interior rules. Formation of a native Hawaiian government that will then be recognized by the United States. My question, you have to stay within that context because it's not.
The rules, why are you here? The federal rules are for domestic recognition.
My question is,
to be recognized,
to establish a Hawaiian government, how do you reconcile that with independence and the formation of a nation?
Because it's two separate sets of claims. It's two separate sets of claims. The native. The recognition of indigenous peoples was established through the UN process, was going to be coexisting until the 1940s. The kingdom was overthrown illegally in 1893. The kingdom's claims will not be impacted by the claims of the native people. The native nation is not claiming to be the kingdom of Hawaii. That's the key.
If the Hawaii nation forms a government, its own constitution, under the DOI rules, will the United States government recognize that nation with a constitution that is separate and apart from the Naʻiapuni? That's the question.
Separate from the
Naʻiapuni. So are you asking if there's two separate documents and two separate constitutions, which one does the United States talk to in international relationships? That's the question. Which one? If there's two constitutions, which right now we're in.
The United States has already said the Kingdom of Hawaii does not exist in numerous United States cases, so I don't think that they would. They're never going to exist to acknowledge it. And that's
really
the last.
Okay, so
let's talk about the they have. What I'm saying is, our claims for our kingdom, we're not going to knock on the United States door and get recognized as a kingdom first. We're going to have to go to the international arena, which goes with what I said earlier. The international arena is where the kingdom claims take place. Simultaneously, we can work with the United States as indigenous people. Not to give up any rights, but to assert more rights and gain more access to them.
I'm going to take a minute real faster, but I know everybody is getting really deep, but I'm just going to say for a minute, let's talk story. Okay, so I'm going to have, and Josh, I'm just going to ask really respectfully, can Josh moderate for this, and then you can just help 1 minute, and then everybody can agree to that? Can we agree to try and keep it short and then not talk over? Please, is that okay? Because this is a conversation, right? Yo, right? You don't want to talk to them. So let's give it a chance, okay? Mahalo.
Understanding with time, yeah, with time. We're not going to be able to get to every single question. Just to manage those expectations, yeah. So out of respect for each other, yeah, if we could, and I want Mahalo if I could probably to moderate, but and you will continue to do this, but if we could ask a specific question so that the panel can answer the specific question, and then we can have a discussion on such specific question. You know? Real agree to all that? Mahalo.
So I'm gonna answer the question that she has to ask for both sides, to ask how you can reconcile the Constitution. And I think it's impossible. You can't, because you have, it's not one building upon the other. The way that this Constitution is written, there's tons of articulation of police, there's the 1864 Eden Constitution. Don't create the processes of which you identify the leadership. And then they're going to take these programs and they're going to run them. That's what the domestic federal recognition they're talking about, they'll run these programs. Is that something?
They can put them together.
So
if they put everything together, do we trust them as a people to listen to what we have in our concerns?
And I think that's really a key factor, is that you can't reconcile the two of them. What's going to happen if you create a world war?
Okay, okay. Kalama. As much as I love, I'm checking too. Okay? Our questions, when I ask some specific questions, our speaker is going to have 2 minutes. Okay? We're going to stop them. I'm just going to tap them on the shoulder, but we're going to stop them and just going to move on. Okay? Okay? We're going to. I really mahalo you guys. Okay? Let's go to the next question, please.
What Indian tribe in the United States of America that's acquired federal recognition ever successfully then secured independence for the United States of America? The answer is none. The question I have, so those that are talking about, if we do federal recognition first, then we do independence, we're precluded. Not only because there's never been a precedent by any Indian tribe to ever successfully do that, but secondly, there's a federal statute that precludes us if we don't recognize the federal tribe. This federal statute precludes us pursuing independence. So on two counts, what you have just stated tonight is completely untrue, because no precedent has been set by a single Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition. And secondly, federal statute, Title 12, does not allow us to move forward past federal recognition if we want to secure independence. So on both counts, you're wrong. So let's get that back to you.
Was there a question? Okay, well, I'm gonna respond really. You're right. However, like I said, a native nation is not going to, it's not able to make the claims of the kingdom. However, if our people begin to build, if we build a government and gain resources, yeah, and we start to build, we can get international recognition and eventually evolve into the kingdom. If that was ever to be decided, a choice.
There's not a single sentence in the DOI rule which would allow you to develop our lands. Where?
What law is it?
Look on page, on 172 page of the rule. Where does it say anywhere that you can develop lands?
It's not part of the great, to point that out, you have to educate once again on what the Department of Interior rules are about. The DOI rules are not a land claim settlement. We would not want lands to be in that process. The DOI rules
isn't even on us. The earlier speaker was a mischaracterization. Department of Interior rules are for them. So it sets up the process of how they would, if a Native Hawaiian government comes forward to have a government relationship with them, the DOI would have to follow Part 50. Number two, Maine, there are over 566 Native American tribes. Three of mine, they have been going to the UN long before we have, and are still going to the UN. So, and holding on to their federal recognition status. What federal recognition does in reality is it allows the Native people to take their assets and resources and control them up under Native control, rather than a state government or even a federal government having all of that control. There are the Dakota, the Navajo, all the federally recognized Native governments are indeed at the United Nations and should be at the United Nations fighting that fight. The real question, sir, is name an Indian tribe that has achieved federal recognition. And sister, I really appreciate it, recognizing the huge chance how long the process, the bar process is for them. Name a Native government. These are smart people too. We're smart, they're smart, that have requested to be unrecognized. Not one. Not a one has said, I don't want my right to the Indian Self-Determination Act. Thank you.
There's awakening, there's awareness. And those are the kind of things
will allow us to achieve what we're going after. But it's a process. It's a process. And we've got to hold one another knee. And we've got to understand that we're in a position where we are only getting stronger. We're only getting stronger. But like what I said, that's the best they've got. We're going to beat. If this is the best America has got, we already got to beat because we're only getting stronger. Three generations ago, my people in the Kuwait tradition, Karikina, Kahto Wila, Nahalua, Makabue, Kumuhane, they signed that tradition. And generation by generation, we became a little bit less Kanaka, a little bit less Hawaiians. But the shift has already occurred and it's turned. And I think that our generation, my generation, is in a better state than the generation before me because of the actions and the struggles that they went through. And if I continue to struggle, my kids and my Mo'opuna and the generations after me, they'll be in a better position. But we've got to struggle. We've got to struggle.
Experiences from my family, many people close to me, point, they struggle a lot. And I know you said that you acknowledge that there's been a struggle. I don't know how deep some people are willing to let a struggle go in order to defeat the system that comes so broken that people must suffer. I'm not sure if they expect people willing to go, but I'm not willing to go to that extent. And I'm going to use education as one example because the engineers over there. A practical solution, a potential solution to a $1 billion budget under the DOE that does not adequately fund grant programs. And I'm not advocating here. I say, she asked for pathways, she asked for specific answers about independence, and I haven't heard anybody ask these questions on international independence or Lima. Under federal recognition, you wouldn't have autonomy with educational system to negotiate with the state and FX to get resources to administer your programs autonomously. Outside of the umbrella of the DOE. I just think that's a practical answer to potential solution.
I am my father's daughter. My father's name is Kanaka O'o Ni'aupio. My name is Uwe Leonardi. I want to share with you what those of us who grew up in Hawaii instead, and are now DCs, and what we're going to go through in about a month. I'm going to read from my poem what is being asked of us by Department of Hawaiian Homes. Public hearing set for December on DHHL's proposed administrative rule changes. State of Hawaii Department of Hawaiian Homeland. Notice of public hearings on proposed amendments to Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules. The Department of Hawaiian Homelands, DHHL, will hold statewide public hearings for Hawaii Administrative Rule amendments. The proposed amendments to the Title 10, Hawaii Administrative Rules, Department of Hawaiian Homelands, cover several topic areas which include the use of DNA testing to help establish familiar relationships for the application and process and successorship designation, subsistence, agriculture lots, etc., etc. That is coming up on December 6th. I am to ask the question. The question is, on both panels, do you feel that a government agency should be making a rule as to who my mother slept with? That is the question. And that's how far they've lowered us. I find this government entity heinous and criminal to be able to make a rule as such.
It's been clear that the United States has only had their own personal agenda in mind. You know, they didn't take us over because they wanted to benefit us. They took us over because they wanted to benefit themselves. And every rule and every Kalakala that they printed has always been to benefit them and not to benefit us. You know, we could have tried to have a win-win, but there has never been an attempt for a win-win. There's been a lose and a win. And they're the ones who are winning. They're the ones who are acting like they're the boss of us. You know, like we said already, nobody gave them permission. My kupuna never gave them permission. I never gave them permission. My kids never gave them permission. So really, it's about us decolonizing our minds. We are not part of it. You know, one of the problems is that they're not formal.
Question is whether the state agency should be deciding those things or telling us what to do. I agree with who. The answer is no. And that is why self-governance at the international arena through independence or at the domestic level through a recognized Native Hawaiian government is so important, so that we are deciding these kinds of things ourselves. No, they should not. State agencies, the federal government should not be making decisions about DNA, blood, etc.
Thank you. Right now, it is 9:38. We're going to change our rules just a little bit, if you guys would allow it. To speak, the questions, they're going to have 30 seconds to just ask the questions. Yeah, and I should have did this a lot sooner. But please ask a specific question, then we can have the speakers answer, and then we're just going to try to ask one question, and then we'll go move on. And I come forward. Mahalo all of you guys' efforts. Appreciate it.
My question is, where is the jurisdiction? We were invaded January 17, 1893. July 7, 1898, we became a territory by two pages. It was a joint resolution. Now, in U.S. constitutional law, a joint resolution has no boundaries outside the boundaries of the United States. And the question is, how does the federal recognition apply to the fact they have a state that doesn't have the islands or the boundaries? Dr. Williams and Chang proved that after 20 years. I'm just saying, where is the jurisdiction for an outside entity known as the state of Hawaii under federal recognition? It's not an entity that has the jurisdiction under two pages of the joint resolution. There's no treaty. That's the problem. The name of the treaty.
Mahalo.
The Department of Interior rules, once again, I will repeat, is not the establishment of a government. It is not a land claim. It does not deal with jurisdiction. It is purely very limited scope. It is the regulatory regulations over the federal government on how it will respond and assess criteria when recognizing and deciding to have a government-to-government relationship with whichever Native Hawaiian government decides and wants to come forward and present itself. The federal regulations are there, they sit there, they may sit there and never be accessed. So they don't, the state, what is, in relation to the answer's question, federal recognition or federal acknowledgement of the government-to-government relationship, once acknowledged, the state is automatic, they don't have a choice. They are part of the system. County governments will not have a choice because they are part of the state aids. But the Department of Interior rules does not address land or jurisdiction, nor should it. Because that is a question of the Native Hawaiian government itself.
No jurisdiction, and so basically it does say the DOI rules that we yield to a plenary power. And so what we have in the international realm and also domestic within American law is that there's no treaty of annexation and that there was no vote in Congress to
to make us a part of the United States. So we have a legal basis that we will yield through this process.
My question has to do with climate change. So we see that America has elected a president who wants to dismantle America's commitments to address climate change. And so for me, that brings up another key urgency to our ability in Hawaii to address climate change. Because scientists have said these islands are going to be impacted more than any other place on the planet. We are going to face that now, and I was glad to hear you say, Robin, that you support independence eventually. But we haven't had any support in terms of dollars to help us do the work that we have to do to get there. I think we need to get there faster because also said that by 2036 we will see sea level rise in these islands. So question is, will you support, and I ask OHA these questions, will you support funding equal for independence to get that work done that was spent thus far on the Akaka bill and every other effort for federal recognition?
You know as well as I, the participant that after we supported independence and was very adamant about any movement going forward needed to be an open process that engaged all voices. So my personal question, my personal answer, based off of the answer and provided what is in the Constitution, is yes. Of course we will support that.
No, I'm asking the question is equal funding for pursuing independence as
yes. All pathways, yes. Just as we discussed in our
office. We should start with OHA.
In regards to climate change, again, we know who's responsible for us. It's not the native people. In fact, it's the native people that scientists around the world agree will bring the answer to the problem. So again, we're going to that point of being part of the colonizing nation makes us part of the people who are destroying the land. If we were to do our own thing like our Kupuna did, we would continue to model the island like they did for thousands of years.
I think you don't really grasp a good point about climate change. I just wanted to respond.
Wow.
Native Hawaiians make up less than 25% of the general population.
The Native American Indians raised this question only in the last 25 or 30 years. The Congress responded by passing the Native Indian Child Welfare Act, which gives to Indian children the right, when they are taken from a dysfunctional family, to be placed with a family that is Indian. At that time, we led to ask for inclusion. We could not get in. Regularly, Hawaiian children are pulled out of their Hawaiian families. They're placed with Oriental families and Maoris. We do not have the right to place our children. But we tried to get in the law. It's like the brother that was the veteran talking about loyalty. I took 25 years of my life to fight for the right of Hawaiian vets and Indian vets to be able to have a benefit when they came out to build a home. Because the veteran benefit was given to all the veterans, but never to an Indian or a Hawaiian, because they lived on trust lands that was communal lands for the people. The same is the case with the United States. There is no right to protect your children other than the Congress saying that. When the Congress passed the Indian Child Welfare Act, They left out all the children. That wasn't recognized. They left out the children of the Pueblos. It wasn't just the Hawaiian children, but to this day, we don't have that right. And that was another big deficiency, that they left out the Na'iapuni Constitution. We wouldn't have it under their federal recognition.
Yeah, actually, I think the answer to your question is that federal recognition allows Native American Indian children to be placed in American Indian homes. So yes, federal recognition does support that you're asking
but
about.
But it's not in our country.
It doesn't have to be in the Constitution. We're not recognized one. It doesn't have to be in the Constitution for that part of that that would be included in a statutory body.
It's not in the Constitution.
The practice among Hawaiians is that we mala ma'o. So in all Hawaiian focused charter schools that have not been supported by the state or the federal government, we make sure all of our teachers are registered across the parents so that they can take the cakey home when they need to be mala ma'o.
I am grateful for the DOI rule, not because I am happy of what was in it, but because it brought Kalahui together, period. We need to have more discussions like this, and I malama you folks, and I malama and I understand that we need to go through a struggle, go through a struggle. And I'm getting to my question, but I'm worried about time. I have dedicated my life, my kupuna have dedicated my life to protect our natural cultural resources. I live it every day, and I see our native wildlife dying every day, along with our whole life, along with all of our resources. I see it dying, just like you guys do. Time is of the essence. Now, I want to know, my question is, I want to have another role right here. What are you folks individually willing to do to answer the tough questions if that is what you want for independence? What are you going to do to work across the table instead of saying, this is my constitution, this is your constitution. I'm not going to give you the Kalahui constitution. You have your constitution over here. I want to know how are we going to work together forward?
You know, there's only one way, and that is to work with your peoples. That is to take the issue out to the community, as we did so many years ago. Four rounds, 53 communities, everyone that was identified by population. But it's almost the traditional districts, many homestead. But to go there and do the work is how you do it. It's not a panel with a few people giving an answer, it's a commitment. You live it with your life. You do it. You do it here. You do it in Washington. We have to go to the state legislature or the United Nations. We will do it. You do it. It's like the lady saying, Le Momi Khan, what is independence? Live it. We didn't have to secede from the union for our educators to say we will bring back our language. We will design this Hawaiian curriculum. That's why we have the pedagogy of Aloha, Hawaiian curriculum developed by who? Do it.
Do it. I would appreciate that you have a little mind out here creating it. These are this panel. They did nobody else put this together but us. For the past 20 years, I've been the co-founder of Kotopana Hikal. We have been putting low-key staff in our communities on every single island for 20 years. I'm a positional officer on Makoka. I am going right now to Aotearoa next to go and be a part of the Pacific Region Indigenous Doctors Conference. I just came back from Standing Rock where I helped I created one of the co-founders of the Standing Rock Medicare Council. So we are a part every single day. Every single day I come in. And this is what we're all and every single Aotearoa I have been striking by every single Aotearoa and you've been welcome.
Every single one. We haven't had any rock game between us. Ever. Ever. Next question. Aloha. I'll be real short of the question. One of my friends, professor of international law, who specializes in human rights and self-determination, who I think is qualified to say what she said. Her name is Maimon Long, many of us know her. She's been an ally for many years. She
She said that during the time of the DOI hearings when it came around to the IMAX, she said that the essence of self-determination, and I'm going to play the self-determination game right now, of course I'm for independence, but she said the essence of self-determination, nothing could be more self-determining than showing up in person and testifying as a real-life human being, testifying your vote, yay or nay. So we were, she said, that is the most powerful expression of self-determination in person. And so we were dismayed to learn that the DOI rules passed, because most of us, many of us, witnessed all the hearings on each item. And some of us, including myself, actually counted the numbers. And the numbers averaged around 150, 155 testifiers. And we counted those numbers, and just about consistent with every hearing on every item, about 95% of the testifiers said, "Apole to the rules. No, we don't want them." So how did they pass is my question. And my understanding is that pro-rule, the people who were in support of the rule passage, organized this postcard campaign where you just check off that you supported and mailed in the postcard. And so, were the postcards counted more than the real-life Tanaka? How did they get passed, is my question to both sides. How do we explain that? Is that really self-determination?
Self-determination is that the most powerful expression is in words that is in person. It's not the, maybe in person. It's not the only way to express support or opposition. But I think that you must understand that the DOI's job was to evaluate the content of the answers. So did you answer the questions being posed? Their question was, we are looking at promulgating a rule. What do you think about this? What do you think about this? Many of the oral testimonies didn't address those questions. It just said, go home. We don't want you here. So you didn't give them something substantial to say. You weren't answering the questions. You were just saying, go home. We don't want your rule. Okay, we noted that. But there was a lot of substantial testimony provided answering those questions that were posed. And I think that there were card campaigns on both sides. Yes, we saw cards for opposition, and we saw cards for, and that's part of what Davis was talking about earlier, engaging. That is our civic duty. We should definitely be engaged. Whether you check a box, get out and write your testimony, do your oral testimony, it all counts. But it comes down to the content. Did you answer the questions that were posed by the new
And the questions that were posed were a broad question in the first place, because they are not to repeat the boss of us. So to come at the boss and ask at the boss, if you're not the boss, then all I can tell you is, go home, you are not the boss. What more is there to do? When our Kukuna signed the Pulera petition, they had a keynote, they read that person, they put him in front of other people as witnesses, and many of them had ramifications because they were pro Hawaii, they were pro the Queen, and many of them lost their jobs, especially those that are working for the state government. So our Kukuna stood up and had the balls to stand up as Hawaii and say, Pulera, and I think all of us Hawaiians should do the same.
I'll only go home. No, we don't want it. It sounds pretty substantial to me.
We have four more questions answered. Mahalo, we're going to follow this up with these last four questions. Mahalo, all of you guys, for your guys' patience.
I do want to make sure that you know that you can go online. There are 5,124 comments that are public. So I encourage you to go online.
points to the DOI ruling. I actually read 172 pages. And I want to ask you all, whoever read that thing, did any of you feel like throwing up? Or sick to your stomach? Because I have never read anything in my life that made me sick to my stomach. When I read that thing, it is filled with generalizations, purposeful avoidance of facts. Never once mentioned that Hawaii in 1843 was established a sovereign nation. Why would you say, who wrote the DOI rule? Who's the author of that thing?
DOI.
Yeah, and another thing is, if you read it, you'll see things. Like how they say, oh, but nobody answered that question. They avoid things in there that are important facts of history. Why did they conjure up this something that would be read by people who are not educated about our history? And they'll say, oh, so that's how they're being here with the Native Hawaiians. Oh, okay, that's what happened. Oh, yeah, so Kamehameha, in there, they say, so King Kamehameha was able to unify the Hawaiian Islands under one kingdom. And then there was a few other monarchs after
question
that were able to keep it going. That's the kind of thing that's said. Who wrote this thing? Who wrote the DOI ruling? Because they kind of put it forth as if it's a sovereignty, but it is not. It's filled with thousands.
The question was, who wrote the DOI ruling?
So, who wrote it?
That's
the question.
Who said,
who wrote the federal rulemaking? Is a long-standing process. Is that a new process?
Author,
can I please answer? So there are federal
author,
regulations that for housing, there's federal regulations done all across the federal government. I want to make sure you're correct because maybe it's partly why there's this contention. The regulations are not on us. The regulations are their regulations on them. And typically, the authors of federal rules depend on what the subject matter is. In this case, the subject matter is the trust relationship and the federal staff, or the legal standing status of Native peoples. And so it involved not only the Department of Interior, it also involved the Department of Justice and attorneys and long-standing folks that have experience. But again, what is important to say, actually, the historical writing in those rules were pretty darn good. And second, again, I say, those rules were not regulations on me as a Hawaiian. They are regulations written by the federal government for the federal government.
I just want to just leave everybody with this. You know, I'm going to summarize the story for you, real quick.
We got three more questions. Disrespect the person behind you by jacking that mic.
Hey,
disrespect the person.
Come on, brother.
Please.
In Sias Mystic, the United States takes to roping to steal the art.
Please,
my
next question. We have three more questions.
We have three more
questions.
This is a question for the federal recognition folks, and I'd like to really mahalo you folks for being here. It's hot seat, and really appreciate it a lot. Okay, my question is, I hear you folks saying, and I've heard this from other folks too, that those two paths of independence and federal recognition are not mutually exclusive, right? And that that they could work together. So my question is, why then, given that, you know, we've definitely heard the concerns of the people over and over again that federal recognition could be used by the United States to claim that the claims of the kingdom are settled. And so if the area concerns that those claims could be, you know, that the kingdom could be set by the United States, right? Regardless of what any of us do. If it could be said that by the United States that, oh, don't worry about it, this is settled, which, by the way, was written in the report that was commissioned by the Office of Hawaiian Affairs last year, James and Maya and Robert Williams, on page 24 and 25 of their report. They did address that, and they basically said that, well, yes, that is a problem. You know, the U.S. certainly could make that claim. However, the only thing that we would need to do would be... The only thing that we would need to do would be to stand up and say that, you know, we deny that. It hasn't been settled. So my question is, why has no one on the federal recognition side stood up visibly and said, we refuse to put our kingdom in this? You know, we want to be very clear that this does not settle anything. I haven't seen that from anyone. I haven't seen a recognition, and so I'm wondering why hasn't there been a recognition of what everyone else is saying and what their concerns are?
First, I want to touch on something I said when I first spoke. I'm not up here, but you may not believe it because it's how you make the money. I'm not an advocate for federal recognition. Because I don't know what federal recognition is going to look like. Because we haven't stood up government, we haven't held elections, and we haven't begun to negotiate with anybody realistically as a Native government. At that time is when I would decide whether I'm a supporter of federal recognition. It is a tool and a pathway that I'm willing to consider. Clarification. Now, to answer your question, it's in the first, I believe, the preamble of the Constitution. Everybody that supported the Constitution on a process moving forward, it left independence on the table. It said that we can still pursue it's specific, and that was a very hard fought battle. That was a very hard fought battle by many in the to include that language in there. And it's in there. So there's different opinions in our Lahui, but they worked it out. Wow.
That was your answer.
We have said it. I have said it.
Yes. And also the DOI rules, the Part 50 rules, already answered the question. There is no necessity under federal recognition to stand up that it cannot apply, does not apply to our international rights, our rights that remain in the kingdom. The Part 50 rule, in fact, kingdom individuals ask specific questions to the DOI in that information process, and the DOI answered them on that point to make sure that they are separate and they do not intertwine. But this is also why I want to say to the young lady, I support both. I support any funding for either to educate our people on either front, that we should continue going to the UN, just like other federally recognized Native nations are funding themselves to go to the UN. It's not or, it is and.
You know, there's only one UN expert in this world, and it's not any of them. And the truth is, you cannot rectify or justify these things. You can take the word independence and stick it in the paper, but it does not provide rights to people. It does not return their land or give them restitution for the overthrow. You can talk words, but it's not the same thing as saying we have our land, we will build homes. That is what the difference is. Instead of saying, if you want independence or if you believe in human rights, go to the United Nations. Wrong. We bring the human rights home. We stay home. You go on.
I'm going to give you the
that you have fully engaged lawyers for this. You can all sign a document saying that they will absolutely refuse any type of government that in any way deals the independent nature of the Hawaiian Kingdom, that we will absolutely refuse any negotiation. And maybe we can start talking about this and say that yes, you can have two different pathways. So if you guys, are you guys willing to all agree on that? That every single 81 of you, that you will absolutely refuse any type of situation that will end you.
I would sign up for something like that. Absolutely. I have to fight for pursuit of independence to be included.
That's an easy yes.
Compromise, that's how the world works.
That's an easy, Peter. That's the
okay, let's work on that offline. Okay.
So this question was already asked, but there was not an experience, and it was in which case has federal recognition ever resulted in any of the Native American tribes achieving sovereignty or trading with other nations? Sovereignty in a real sense.
Independence.
But I clarify that the native people is different than the claims of the kingdom.
Yes.
Okay.
I think that's a critical point. And also, there have never been an unrecognized native group, but there are about 60 that are applying for recognition now. They have also not been recognized, nor have they achieved any pin from the International Marine Native Department. Okay?
That's because there is none. That's because there is none. If that's not a document, it's not going to happen. Regardless of what they're saying, there isn't any.
We said
there wasn't any, we would have seen it by now.
And Kalamoy, we're in overtime. It's 10 o'clock. I'm going to put my hat over here because we need some donations. We're going to continue this discussion, but somebody's got to pay the custodian. Ahaloha Aina will. So if those who want to help contribute to Ahaloha Aina so we can continue this discussion, please join right here. Let's keep going with the questions.
Aloha.
My question. Are you going to know Robin Banners? Yeah, well.
Hey, come on.
Mahalo.
You're acting like you know us. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Aloha, my question for both
panels.
Josh. Mahalo, everyone. Mahalo. It's going to go fast to Nani right here. That's Nani. Put it on that chair.
Was broken. That's why I personally, I never speak for anybody else,
I did not believe that the best way to approach that process was to disengage. That's me. And I don't judge anybody else who took their own pathway to disengage, protest, participate. I say for me, I wanted to get in there to see what work was being done and what was going to come out. Now, I know that I didn't want to represent anybody but my Ohana. That's it. Okay? And that's what I went in there and spoke on behalf of. So now, and fought to ensure that nobody in there, watching, to make sure that nobody in there was going to take that product and try to do anything that represented our people without taking it out to the people first. And I can assure you that that constitution will not have any impact on anyone unless it's voted on by our Lahu or our potential Lahu.
Okay, now, question is.
But why shouldn't it even be voted on when it was developed by a long process? I mean, I don't get this. You know, as a teacher, I wouldn't allow you to take something that was never and then tell you vote on it when you already know it was never and you have admitted that the process is flawed. So that is not a constitution. You shouldn't call it a constitution because it was not created the way constitutions are created, which is two delegates. And certainly, some of the people, and I have to say my own students included, certainly would have never been delegates if there was a vote.